Leptin and melatonin are two hormones which are also relevant for homeostasis, and I'm going to talk about them right now in the next couple of slides. The hormone leptin is associated or has some kind of connection with obesity. And let's look at the mouse over here. The mouse on the left side, as you can see, is a little bit overweight compared to the normal mouse over here on the right side. And the reason is that this mouse essentially could not control its eating behavior and continued eating, until it grew a little bit overweight. Leptin is a hormone, and it is produced by adipose cells, and adipose cells are fat cells. These are the cells which are important for storing fat in the body, and the fat cells which release the leptin is released into the blood and is transported to the hypothalamus in the brain, and there it causes the inhibition of appetite. So in other words, a lot of fat in many fat cells in the body means more leptin production, means that the appetite is decreased. This is an example of negative feedback. Now, what they've tried now is the following: is they tried to inject the leptin into humans who were overweight, and interestingly, it was mostly not successful. In most obesity cases are due to insensitivity of the hypothalamus to leptin and not because not enough leptin was there in the first place. However, there is a small percentage of obesity cases which are due to mutations in the leptin gene, and in these rare cases, injection of leptin might indeed work in reducing the appetite. Now, in contrast, the leptin injections into obese mice was successful. The mouse over here had a genetic disorder and was not able to produce leptin, and therefore its appetite was not reduced. But essentially, in this case, you could inject leptin into the mouse, and this resulted in a reduced appetite. So that is basically what we expected. Higher metabolism, the cell respiration rate increased, so more of the fat was burned. And of course, also the body mass changed. The body mass was decreased around 30% each month, which is quite significant. So this kind of shows that experiments which worked in mice do not necessarily always work in human beings, because the biochemistry is different, or because there can be other reasons why the body does not, why leptin is not able to inhibit appetite. Over here, in the case of the mouse, there was not enough leptin produced in the first place. This could be treated with injections. In most cases with humans, it's not a lack of leptin, but simply because the hypothalamus does not respond to the leptin. So basically, there were several issues or several examples in here that basically leptin is important for controlling body mass, but at the same time, this example also shows that animal experiments cannot in all cases be directly transferred to human example. So that was basically leptin. What about melatonin? Melatonin is associated with the so-called circadian rhythms. And the circadian rhythms are the daily rhythms that we humans have. It's like the wake and sleep rhythm. But there are other things also involved. First of all, how does the human body know whether it's day or night? Well, of course, there are receptor cells in the eye, ganglion cells in this case, in the retina in the eye, detect the light and darkness, and this again sends a signal to the hypothalamus in the brain. And melatonin is a hormone. Secretion increases in the evening and then drops again in the morning, so you have daily cycles in melatonin production. And these cycles influence the daily rhythms that we humans have. So for example, in the case of a jet lag, when you're traveling over many time zones in an airplane, then some people have a problem adapting to the new day-night cycle. And the reason is that basically the body continues with the old melatonin production rhythm for a couple of days until it's able to adapt to the new day-night rhythm. And during this time, the body gets a little confused, or can become a little confused, and this causes the jet lag. And there are some symptoms over here: sleeping problems, fatigue, which is tiredness, headache, and irritability. And the chemical formula over here, that's the chemical formula of melatonin. And I included this here because I just wanted to show you that essentially a lot of behaviors that we humans have are indeed influenced or also partially even controlled by chemicals. So this kind of begs the question a little bit, if this is the case, to what extent do we have a free, how shall I say, a free will to a certain extent? Or to what extent is not our daily cycle and our constitution not also partially determined by our own chemicals? And indeed, there are examples where this actually shows that this is indeed the case. Now, there is also some age dependency in relating to melatonin production. So for melatonin secretion decreases with age. And this is also the reason why sleeping patterns also change with age. So, for example, young children, they have a greater need for sleep, for example, than adults and even older people. And simply to give you an example that melatonin is not only related to sleeping patterns, but also has an influence on other factors. There is a nice diagram over here. That's a circadian rhythm of a human. So noon, then at midnight is down here. So best coordination seems to be around 2:30 in the afternoon, fastest reaction time, then greatest cardiovascular efficiency, highest blood pressure, highest body temperature. Now, I guess these must be average values, of course, but very interesting over here at 9 o'clock in the evening at 2100 hours over here, look at this, melatonin secretion starts. And this also results in the bowel movement suppressed. Okay, that's of course very important, otherwise you go to the toilet while you're sleeping, that's something you do not want. You have a deepest sleep at around 2 o'clock. And over here, look at this again, melatonin secretion stops again here at in the morning. So, and that's basically an example of the circadian rhythm, and that should illustrate that humans are not only subjected to sleep-wake cycles, but also to a lot of other, or several other changes throughout the day as well. A high alertness, for example, at 10 o'clock in the morning. For example, in my case, I have a very big problem working right afternoon, in the afternoon, but I'm very much awake again starting 10 o'clock at night. And so you also see that there is an individual personal cycle, day-night cycle, which can also take over maybe, or can also play a greater role simply by the because people are getting used to something because there are certain habits. So I would actually say it's not entirely controlled by hormones. It has a strong control, but of course things like daily habits and issues like this also of course can play a significant role, and probably overlaps with the biological rhythm as well. Okay, so this was basically a simple, not a simple, but a general overview. Some of you might wonder if you have to remember all of these things here. No, that's not the point. The idea is more simply to give you an overview of all the events that go on in the human body throughout the day.